Hello and welcome back to our course Physics and Chemistry of the Interstellar Medium, lecture number 12. Today we have five sections and we continue on our discussion of the energy balance in the interstellar medium. In the previous lecture we were looking at the dominant heating mechanisms. We were discussing the photoelectric heating and also the heating by molecular hydrogen. Today we continue and look at other heating mechanisms that become important under certain conditions. We look how they compare under different physical conditions in different physical environments. We will then have a look at how they compare to the efficiency of the various cooling contributions. We already discussed cooling physics in the previous sections about the radiative transfer. So how line emission actually escapes a molecular cloud. And then summarizing the heating and cooling, we look at the interplay between the two and how the balance between heating and cooling then actually establishes a certain balance between certain stable configurations of the gas, so stable gas density and gas temperature conditions that might actually coexist in the interstellar medium, and then look at the more realistic actual situation where we also find non-equilibrium configurations in the interstellar medium. So this picture here shows what I already mentioned about the coexistence between various stable phases of the interstellar medium. We have here a molecular cloud interface. So we have the ionized gas region here. This is the bright light blue areas where most of the gas is very hot, a few thousand Kelvin, and with densities that are pretty low in the order of one particle per cubic centimeter or even below. And we have basically here a very sharp boundary where the conditions of the gas change significantly, where it's pretty dense, so a few thousand or even higher particles per cubic centimeter and temperature, which are only in the regime of tens or maybe 100 Kelvin. And they coexist in a stable configuration with very sharp boundaries and strong density gradients. And we will see today how these configurations arise and why they are stable. So another heating mechanism that we haven't discussed so far arises from the interaction of dust and gas particles. So we have collisions between dust and gas particles, and given their much different velocities and energies, these collisions can exchange energy between gas particles and the dust grains. The overall dynamics of the interstellar medium, determined by the gas pressure, is basically driven by the gas temperature. So this changes depending on the driving of the gas, the kinematic properties of the dust are much less affected, and they are more driven by the direct heating of by ultraviolet and even infrared radiation. As a consequence, dust and gas will have different temperatures most of the time. This is shown here in the figure. These are model computations of a PDR model. On the left, we see the gas temperature. This is the gas temperature here, and this is the dust temperature. We have here the surface, or regions close to the surface of the cloud. This is here the center, so we go deeper into the cloud, into the molecular cloud in this direction, and you see that on the surface we have temperatures in the regime of many hundreds or even a few thousand Kelvin, while when we move deep into the cloud, we have something between 10 and 20 Kelvin gas temperature here in the cloud. The different lines are from different model assumptions, including or excluding certain heating mechanisms. So for example, the dashed and dotted lines include a very efficient heating by the H2 molecule here, which is not considered in the solid line, which makes the gas, of course, then hotter as long as this heating is effective. On the right-hand side, you see that the dust temperatures, now here the y-axis is not a logarithmic axis anymore. We are here in the regime of 10, so 100 Kelvin, so much lower. And we also note that the dust temperature is not a single temperature, but it depends on the dust particles, so on the size of the particles and on the composition. So the dashed lines here show the temperatures of the very small particles, the PAHs, which are much hotter. We saw this already in the previous lecture. So they have temperatures on the surface up to 100 or even higher Kelvin, while the bulk particles, the silicates and the graphites, are only 40 to 50 Kelvin warm. In the center, they all have basically the same temperature. This is because here the ultraviolet radiation is not strong enough anymore to significantly heat the dust particles. So they are all more or less on the same temperature. And the solid curves here gives the average between all these different dust components to allow to talk about something that is a dust temperature. There are different ways to actually compute this. Here, this is the surface area weighted dust temperature, because it is argued that the surface of the dust particles is actually the important weighting factor, because this is where the interaction between the gas particles takes place. So the more surface we have, the more collisions these components will have with the gas particles, and more energy transfer, heating or cooling, will take place. Now to the actual heating and cooling rates. The heating and heating, or the interaction between the gas and the dust, is basically described by the energy transfer for the thermal coupling between gas particles that collide with the grains and either are reflected, maybe in an elastic collisions, or may stick to the grain, and with the result of a fully inelastic collision, and all the energy carried by the gas particle is now on the grain particles. Of course, there's a continuum between these two extreme cases, so we might have particles that stick to some degree and then are released. Again, this is described by what is called the accommodation coefficient, so the probability that something actually remains on the grains, or diffraction of energy that is transferred between the two. And this is an actually this is actually a field where very little knowledge is existing. There are very few studies on this. There are a few papers about model results. So we are here really in a rough approximation regime. So the this coupling depends on, of course, the on a number of ingredients. So we have the actual cross section or the probability that the two components interact. That is basically the cross section times the density. So we have the dust density times the cross section of the dust. Then we have the collision rate that is given by the thermal velocities, the thermal motion, and this depends here on this prefactor of square root 8 over pi, and then K Boltzmann times the gas temperature, which gives the kinetic energy of the gas, divided by the mean molecular weight. And then the actual heating and heating rate depends on the energy difference between the two in a collision, and that is given by the basically difference between dust and gas temperature. So converted here to energies. KB, T gas, times an efficiency factor, which is here this accommodation coefficient. We can, for a certain mean molecular weight, simplify this and write that this is 6 times 10 to the minus 12 electron volt per second times density in units of cubic centimeter times the square root of the gas temperature in Kelvin, and this multiplied with the difference of the dust to the gas temperature, also given in Kelvin. Now, this is, and this heating rate is only an actual heating rate, so a positive number, when the dust temperature is larger than the gas temperature. Because only in this case, the energy transfer will be such that energy is transported from the dust to the gas, which constitutes a heating. In the opposite case, we will have an actual inverse energy transfer direction. So we will have a cooling. So dust and gas coupling can both heat or cool. And this depends on the sign of this parenthesis here in the expression. So on the fact that the dust is warmer than the gas. And the branching between the two cases is given by the relative strengths of the infrared and the ultraviolet radiation. When we have a very thin gas, we already saw that the ultraviolet radiation is able to penetrate the gas, and the UV photons directly heat the gas through photoelectric effects or through H2 heating. As a consequence, the gas will be very warm. We saw this in the previous plot. On the surface, where UV radiation is strong, the gas temperature is higher than the dust temperature, and we will have a cooling. Yeah, so we will have a gas dust cooling. This is probably taking place in the diffuse interstellar medium, where we have gas temperatures of, let's say, 8000 Kelvin, and dust temperatures in the regime between a few 10 and maybe 100 Kelvin. or in photon-dominated regions where we have temperatures of the gas of a few hundred or maybe a few thousand Kelvin. This should be actually a few thousand. And dust temperatures, naja. Let's say something in that regime. On the other hand, if the gas is relatively dense, if we have thick gas, then the UV photons are quickly absorbed by the dust and converted to infrared radiation that is emitted by the dust layers, and the infrared photons then heat the dust, but they are not able to heat the gas. And in this regime, we will actually have heating, because now the dust temperature is higher than the gas temperature. This is, for example, the case in the interiors of molecular clouds, where we have gas temperatures, let's say 10 of 10, and dust temperatures of something like 18 Kelvin, or in star-forming cores, where we have higher temperatures of the gas, but also higher dust temperatures. And here it's clear that now energy can be moving from the dust particles to the gas particles and heat the gas. Another important heating mechanism can be heating by cosmic rays. So cosmic rays basically are very energetic particles, or maybe also radiation, that is able to ionize hydrogen. Energetic here means we have energies involved in the MeV range, which means a collision between such an energetic particle and a hydrogen atom can of course ionize hydrogen. It only takes 13.6 electron volts to ionize hydrogen. But this also automatically means that we have a lot of excess energy after the ionization, so we can have further interaction between the ionized particle or the electrons and the gas, and can have secondary ionizations, for example. So the total ionization rate that we can have by cosmic rays is here given by this chi cosmic rays, which is the primary ionization rate by cosmic rays, zeta, times the ionization efficiencies, phi, of hydrogen and helium as the two most abundant elements. And they depend on the energy that is available and the electron fraction of the gas. Because when the electron fraction is too high, we will have collisions between Coulomb scattering with other electrons much more frequently. So it's more likely that these energetic particles collide with other electrons and not with neutral particles that they can ionize. So the efficiency goes down. And when the ionization fraction is below 10 to the minus 4, which is a typical value, for example, in the diffuse medium or in molecular clouds, we find a chi cosmic ray in the order of 1.8 of zeta. So we will have about 0.8 secondary ionizations per primary hydrogen ionization. So converting this into actual rates gives us something like 2 times 10 to the minus 16 ionizations per second. And when we look at the average energies per primary ionization of about 7 electron volts, we find a heating rate by cosmic rays when we introduce this factor of 1.8 of 12 electrons times theta cosmic ray. So the probability of an ionization times the average energy per ionization is then the actual heating rate. The same is also, of course, a possible mechanism when we are looking at X-rays instead. We also find about 0.8 secondary ionizations per primary ionization, but the X-ray fluxes have a much stronger spatial dependence. So that attenuation, so the direction from which they are coming and entering a cloud, is much more important here. So we have to integrate over all angles and all the energies here, so that we find a dependence then of the attenuation, which is a function of the cross section times the column density. That gives us then the actual optical depth, the tau, and the cross section here has a dependence on the actual energy of our X-rays as function of the photon energy. That depends, of course, on certain threshold energies, depending then on the elements that provide the shell structure here. And the plot shows you dependence of the cross-section multiplied with e to the power of 3 as a function of the energy. And you see here these steps assigned to these various elements. We already discussed in the section on the hydrodynamics that we also have, of course, energy converted by dissipation. So we saw that we have, given by the energy conversation and cascade of energy through the various scales, injected at a maximum scale L, the energy will be handed down to the eddy spatial scales on a certain time scale that depends on just the ratio between the average size and velocities in our turbulence. And this gives us then a turbulent heating rate. That depends on these scales. And for certain conditions, so in the diffuse, this turbulent heating is in the order of 2 times 10 to the minus 18 electron volt per second. And when we compare this here with the cosmic ray, you see that we are a few orders of magnitude higher. When we are in molecular clouds, we have higher densities and we have higher heating than correspondingly. So there's also the addition of heating processes for some regions. For example, we saw that we can have ambipolar diffusion when the ions and the neutral particles can move with respect to each other. Collisions of these will also inject energy and heat the gas. We can have gravitational collapse and then the release of the potential energy will also heat the gas.